All right, so here we are in the second half of the class, and we're going to start focusing on kind of the other end of derivatives. Whenever you've done math, you've always learned the inverse operators. So maybe when you learned addition, the very next thing you learned, subtraction. You learned how to do something, then you learned how to undo it. So you learned multiplication, and then you learned division. You learned how to do something, then you learned how to undo it. So what we're going to work towards here is we're going to work towards the concept of integrals, which, as you can guess, is going to have something to do with undoing derivatives. This is going to be the inverse operator of derivatives. But before we can get there, it's really important to make sure we can talk about meaning, because it's more important than just understanding how to find them, just knowing there are derivative rules backwards. So instead of worrying about that, let's start by worrying about what do they mean, how do they use it, how do we use them, how are they helpful? Okay, so to get us going here, I'm giving you a table of values here where you just notice there's time and hours, and then we have velocities. And what I want you to do is, given the values in the car, estimate the distance the car traveled in 4 hours. Note, I want 4 hours of travel. Now, go ahead and pause the video. This is something that you should be able to do on your own. Just it's a critical thinking exercise. It's not really difficult math, don't need any derivatives. Just go ahead and try to see if you can answer this problem. All right, pause the video. Go ahead. Okay, so there are two p possible ways that I usually see come up in class when people do this. And if you caught on to it, you will notice our table's starting at zero. It's not starting at one. So going for 4 hours, driving for 4 hours would mean going from the zeroth hour to the first hour. That'd be 1 hour. Then this would be 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours. So meaning, during that first hour, I traveled 23 miles an hour. So the idea here would be for 1 hour, I traveled 23 miles an hour. Then for the second hour, going from the one to the two, we traveled 70 miles an hour. So again, that's another hour, and we drove 70. And then this will continue so on and so forth. 65 miles an hour plus another 70 miles an hour. Now you'll notice here this would make 4 hours of travel. And notice we did not use the 20. So the idea here is if we to go to talk about going 4 hours here to do this, we used four velocities. Even though the table has five listed, we only used four. And so now you can go ahead and say, all right, what would this add up to be? Let's see. 70, it's 140, 205, 205 plus 23. So that would be what? 228. So our assumption would be at 228 miles. And we can also verify our units by thinking about, all right, the units on this one is hours, and then the velocity was 23 miles per hour. So there you can see the units divide, leaving you with just miles. So this is going to be the units of miles plus miles plus miles plus miles equals miles. All right, that's one way of doing it. Now the other way, it's actually the same way, but it's just assuming, instead of saying assuming we're going to use the 23, let's use the 70, 65, 70, and 20. So saying we're going to use this for our first hour of travel. We're going to estimate we average 70 miles an hour for our first hour, then we average 65 miles an hour for a second, and then so on and so forth. So this would be 1 hour at 70 miles an hour, plus 1 hour at 65 miles an hour, plus 1 hour at 70 miles an hour, plus 1 hour at 20 miles an hour. So therefore, this is going to what? Give us 140, 100, 205. So this would be 200 and, is that correct? Yep, 225 miles. So my question for you is, which one of these seems more correct? Which one of these seems better? Because somebody might argue, well, you know, the 23 would be when you were just leaving. You're pulling out of your driveway. That's why it's a little slower than everything else. Or the f at the 4 hours, somebody would say, I don't know, you're in traffic. I don't know. Well, whatever the case, we're not going to really worry about which one's more correct. It's just being able to understand that there's two different interpretations that give us possible answers. Okay, so let's now see what we can do with this. Now, I promise you this is going to be related. All right, so now here we go. We're going to find the area under the curve of y equals x squared plus 3 going from the interval of 0 to 5 using geometric shapes. Okay, so can we very quickly sketch this graph? Let's think about it. All right, this is y equals x squared plus 3, which means it's shifted up 3, parabola opening up, right? Okay, now we're only going from 0 to 5. So you know what I'm actually going to do? Since we only care about the x value of going 0 to 5, so let's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's go ahead and spread this thing way out. Okay. And we could say it goes the same on the other way, but we don't care because we're only limiting it to 0 to 5. Now, let's get our y values. Let's get some y values here. When I plug in 0, I get out 3. When I plug in 1, I get out 4. So this right here, that point right there should be 1, 4. Then when I plug in 2, when I substitute in 2, this value should be what? 2 squared is 4. 4 plus 3 would be, 7. And then when I substitute in 3, 3 squared is 9. 9 plus 3 would be 12. And I think you're getting the idea here. 4 squared is 16. Let's see. So actually what I'll do is I'll make a list over here. Or I can even make a table of values. Why don't we make a table of values? X and Y. When I plug in 1, I get out 4. When I substitute in 2, I get out 7. When I substitute in 3, I get out 12. When I substitute in 4, that's 16. That's 19. And when I substitute in 5, that's 28. Okay. There we go. All right. So now we can have a little bit of, we can imagine what's going on here. So now, using geometric shapes. So what this means is, all right, to estimate the area under the curve, we need some shapes. What kind of shapes could we use? Well, if we want area, what is a really easy shape for us to use that we know really well? We could use triangles or trapezoids or something fun. But probably the easiest version of it, I would say, was a rectangle. Do you guys agree? I hope you do. So why don't we use rectangles? So to represent the area under the curve, oh, and you know what I left off of this list that I should have put on here? What about 0, right? When I substitute in 0, I get out 3. There we go. That looks a little better. Okay, so let's use some rectangles. So what I could do, just similar to the last problem, if I use the first y value and go over and say, okay, there's my first rectangle. So you'd see it has a height of 3. And a width of 1, because I'm going from 0 to 1. Now, when I substitute in 1, it has a height of 4 and a width of 1. Now, when I go to 2, it should have a height of 7 and a width of 1. When I go over to 3, I want to pick a different color here. How about pink? So 1, 2, 3. What's the height at 3? Well, the height at 3 was 12. And let's see. I'm trying to estimate from 0 to 5. So right now I'm going from 0 to 1, 2, 3, 4. I need one more rectangle. Okay, how about we use orange? All right. There we go. So what we can see here is I've used 5 rectangles to go from 0 to 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And now, to estimate the area under the curve, well, could we simply just find the area of each of these rectangles and then add them up? Now, it wouldn't be a perfect estimate, because what we can already tell is there's some error. If you stop and look and say, all right, there is space. Whoops, that is way too thick. Let's get a better, something better than that. What I'll do, I guess I'll use like a purple pen. So what you can see here is there's error. There are spaces that are not filled in. There's a little space right there that's not filled in. There's another space right there that's not filled in. And as we got closer, the space, the error was smaller and smaller. But here, as we move further and further away, you can see there's all this area, this purple area, that is not good. That area is not good at all. It's error. But we could still get an estimate, right? Okay, so the width of our first, so the area under the curve would be approximated by the width of the first rectangle, which is 1, because it's going from 0 to 1, and then the height. Well, I got that height from picking the, when I plug in 0, I got out 3, so therefore it's 3. Now my next rectangle, my blue one, again has a width of 1 and a height of 4. When I substitute in 1, I get out 4. All right, so then our next rectangle, when I substitute in 1, or sorry, not when I substitute in 1, when I substitute in 2, because that was where I got the height of the rectangle, I got out 7. And I think what you can see going on here, I need my pink pen. Again, this pink rectangle here, and I could even color them in if it helps you see it. The pink rectangle here only went up to where, when I plugged in 3, I got out that value on the graph. So I plugged in 3, I got out 12. And we're almost done here. We have one more rectangle to go, one orange one to do. So let's grab our orange pen. And you can see here, it would be this rectangle here. And again, the height of that rectangle came from substituting in 4. When I substitute in 4, I got out 19. And now we can go ahead and add all these up. And so that would just be 3 plus 4 plus 7 plus 12. Whoops. 7 plus 12 plus 19. So we now have an estimate of 45. So our estimate says the area under the curve is about 45. But there's an issue with this. We know this is too low. We know this estimate is not good, because what you can see here is we've had all this purple area that was not shaded. It was area under the curve that we didn't shade. So what if instead of using the left-hand sides of a rectangle, so you notice what I did is I used the left-hand side of the rectangle I drew and said, how high should it be? When I did the left-hand number, so I could either choose 0 or 1 for my first rectangle. Well, I used the 0. So I plugged in 0, I got out 3. Then for my next rectangle, it goes from 1 to 2. Well, I used the left number, I used the 1, which gave me 4. And then, so you get the idea? So this would be a left approximation. Well, what if instead of doing a left approximation, what if we did a right approximation? What would that look like? What would that look like? Well, it's the same idea. It's the exact same idea, except now, just draw a quick sketch. There we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right. So now, for my rectangles, instead of using the left-hand side to get the height, I'm going to use the right-hand side to get the point. So what we'll do here is we'll say there's my 2. And then we need green, which should be my 3. Whoa, that was not a good bar I just drew right there. Let's try that again. And then 4 was pink. And you may already be seeing the punchline here, where the other one was an underestimate. We had all that extra area under the curve. Now we're having a different scenario, right? When I'm using the right-hand approximation, instead of getting all the extra area under the curve, now what you can see is we're getting, let me get my purple pen for the error. Instead of getting all the extra area under the curve, we're getting all sorts of extra area over the curve, which means instead of being predicting too little of a number, this is going to predict too big of a number. We are absolutely capturing, whoops, didn't want to erase that. We're absolutely capturing all of the area under the curve. The problem is we're just capturing too much. We're also getting some stuff above the curve. So let's figure out this area. As you can probably already figure out, this number is going to be bigger than 45. The width of each of these rectangles is still 1. But now, with the height of my rectangle, the height of my red rectangle, okay, this height, where did it come from? Did it come from plugging in 0 or plugging in 1? Well, since it's a right-hand approximation, it comes from the right side, which means substituting in 1. So when I subbed in 1, I got out 4. Then for my next rectangle, which would be my blue one, when I sub, it has a width of 1 once again. And when I subbed in 2, I got out 7. There's my blue. Okay. And then what comes next after the blue? That would be green. So then, again, has a width of 1. And when I subbed in 3, I got out 12. And you can probably go ahead and finish this up on your own, but I'll go ahead and write them out anyway. So the pink, and then finally the orange, right, has a width of 1 and a height of 28. So, and as we hopefully are going to predict, this number should be bigger than the underestimate. This should definitely be on a prediction on that's different. So let's see. Let's go ahead and add these up. This would be what? 4 plus 7 plus 12 plus 19. Whoops. 19 plus 28. 28. There we go. And it came out to be 70. All right. So we got an area of 70. So now the question is which one's the right area? Well, neither of them right. We could see graphically one of them overestimated and one of them underestimated. So sometimes if we have more time in a class, I'll challenge the students to see if they can come up with a method that's better. Well, since we don't have a ton of time in this class, one suggestion I would have is, well, could you average these two values? We know that if this one's too little and this one's too much, then maybe a better area approximation would just be the average of the underestimate plus the overestimate divided by 2. That would be one suggestion for a better estimate on the area. Or another idea here is why are these estimates so bad? Why are they so far apart? Well, it's because we're using only how many rectangles? What? We only used 5 rectangles. So what if we used more rectangles? What would that do? So, and you can see I accidentally, just in my notes, find the area under the curve. This is what we just did, using left endpoints and right endpoints. That's what we just did. Okay, so we already did those two problems. I just did them in the wrong spot. So what if we used more points? Well, instead of using 5 subdivisions, instead of breaking it up into 5 rectangles, what if we use more rectangles? So what we do is we call that subdivisions. So we can do the exact same problem with the exact same parabola, still going from 0 to 5, but instead of using 5 rectangles, why don't we use 10? Why don't we use 10 rectangles? So if you want to try this, give it a pause, and you can think about it. And otherwise, I'm going to run through it here. So the idea, once again, is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We're still going to be going from 0 to 5, except we're going to break this up into 10 rectangles. So now, instead of it having a width of 1, because we need 10 rectangles, it's going to have a width of a half, right? Which kind of makes sense, because if widths of 1 was 5 rectangles, then widths of a half would make 10 rectangles. So now when we draw well, we can make a table of values, and one easy way to make a table of values in this scenario would be let's pop this into our y equals line of our calculator. So that'd just be x squared plus 3. Let's make sure, well, in the window, since we are going to have it doing kind of over even intervals, whoops, sorry, not window, table set, instead of ask, this is one of the scenarios where auto sometimes makes sense. Starting at 0 and counting by, well, the idea here is we want it counting by halves, but what you could say is, if it was harder to do, what you could say is, well, it's a width of how much? I'm going from 0 to 5, so that's 5 across. So therefore, I have a width of 5, and I'm dividing it into 10 subdivisions, and you can see that's the width of each of your rectangles. So now when I go to the table, I can see when I substitute in 0, I get out 3. When I substitute in a half, I get 3.25. When I substitute in 1, I get out 4. And you can even see that, that it's exactly those numbers. So we got our table of values. So now, this problem wants us to use right endpoints. Okay, so if we're using right endpoints, I personally think it's easier to start literally on the right and say, what would that look like? Well, on this first rectangle here that I need to fill in, I'm starting on the right-hand side, which means my rectangle, to get my width, the area, using right endpoints. Let's try spelling the word area. There we go. So it's going to have a width of 1/2 or 0.5, and it's going to have a height of, well, when I plug in 5, what do I get out? When I plug in 5, I get out 28 plus. So now my next rectangle, well, that's going to come from 4.5 if you see it's in between. So again, it has a width of a half, but the output comes, oops, excuse me, the output comes from plugging in 4.5, which would be 23.25. And we can continue with this, so on and so forth. As we fill it in here, every time they're going to have a width of a half. So for those of you who are algebra superstars, you might be realizing, hey, instead of writing all these 1/2, couldn't I just factor that out and say this is the same thing as 28 plus 23.25 plus 19? And the answer is absolutely. That makes it a little easier. And we're going to go ahead and just keep adding until we get 10 rectangles. So I'm going to go through my table of values here and just write down all my numbers until I have 10 of them. So this would be 15.25 plus 12 plus 9.2, 12 plus 9.25 plus 7. Oh, I have to arrow up over here. There we go. Plus 5.25 plus 4 plus 3.25, and that should be 10 of them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Perfect. The other way to tell is if you stop and think for a second, you say my last rectangle has to go to 0. Right? And so therefore I can't use 0. 0 would be, if 0 is not on the right-hand side, 0 is on the left-hand side of my last box. So I'm going to stop at 0.5. All right, so now we're going to add all these up. I'm actually just going to pause the video while I do that, and I'll unpause it with the answer. All right, and I got, assuming I typed everything in the calculator right, I got 63.125. And does that make sense? We knew back from the previous time we did this problem, when we did the overestimate, we got 70. Does it make sense that our area is less now? Well, I think if you stop and think about it, you'd say, okay, now, since I've drawn littler rectangles, the amount of error is going to be, should be smaller. Because instead of sticking with this height, with the old problem where we stuck with this height for a whole box, so you can see it used to come all the way out to here, which means we had all that extra error. But so instead, what we're doing is we're cutting it off half. Cutting it off half a box earlier, half a width earlier, so all that extra area that we would have had, all that extra error, is no longer being counted. So then similarly, on the old problem, we would have been going across here, and then coming down. Let's see, yeah, across there, and then coming down here. So you can see more extra error would have been there. So yeah, it seems like it makes sense. The number should have been smaller. We have less error. So the fun part about this is you can say, this is better. This is better. Still not perfect. We still have error. So let's do it again now using 100 subdivisions. I will see you in a few hours. Good luck with that. I'm just kidding. Let's not do 100. But do you get the idea? Can you make a prediction? The area is less than 63.125, right? Okay, so now there is a fun little website here, just to help you kind of see what's going on. Now, the link to this is in MathAS. It's right here in, you'll see right here, with the textbook section, extra help, Riemann sum visualing website. That's this one right here. And it doesn't do any graph you want. There's a very few selected graphs you can play with, but I think it's enough to get you the idea. So right now, this is the function of y equals x squared. And you can see what's going on here. Ignore this notation. This will be make more sense by the end of the lesson. And here you can see they're using, let's do left rectangles. There we go. So we will do some left approximating. So you see they're going from negative 2 the left hand, there's our rectangle. Then we have another rectangle, and so on and so forth. And here they've broken it up into 10 rectangles. Now, if we want to make it more similar to the one we did, we could move the slider so it's starting at 0. There we go. And you can see left rectangles, they're all underestimates. And what's going to happen though? As we increase the number of rectangles, right now we're using 10. And you can watch here, what we can say here is this is the approximate area under the curve, is 7.621 right now. And they're also telling you the exact area is actually 8.914. So you can see it's underestimating, which makes sense because we've got all this empty space that we're supposed to be counting. But as I increase the number of rectangles that we're using, do you see what's happening to that area? While there is still error, there is still mistakes. Let's see if I can zoom in. You can see the error under there. There's still little error areas, but they've gotten much smaller. And I've gone to 36 rectangles at this point. You can see now the approximation using all 36 of those rectangles is 8.546. And we can get this, I don't know how, let's see how big this will let me get it. Oops, it reset to 10. Let me do it now. I don't think it likes me anymore. Let's refresh the page. Make this again back to left approximating. There we go. Now let's see what we do. There we go. The best we can do is 40. So I think you get the idea, and that's the key. That's the key. And you can see with 40 approximating rectangles, I did get my slider back to the exact same spot. I got negative 0.02. But you get the idea here that the more rectangles, there we go, the more rectangles we have, the closer the approximation is to the exact. Now, the other idea that we can play with here, is one that I kind of alluded to in the beginning, which was you can use other geometric shapes. You don't have to use rectangles, and left and right rectangles. So then there's your picture, you're right. What about middle? What if instead of using the left-hand side or the right-hand side to get your value, what if you use the middle? So plug in 0.5, get that height. Plug in 1.5, get that height. Well, that's pretty good because now you get a little over approximation, a little under approximation. So you can see we're actually with three approximating rectangles with using the middle, we're at 8.75 compared to 9, which is actual. Where if I go back to like the left, we're way off. Or if I go to the right, we're way off. So anyway, so you can see the middle makes sense that it's a better approximation. Just logic. We have a little over, a little under for each of the rectangles. And as I increase my rect, I'll go here so you can see better. There's 10, so you can see it's getting a little even better. And as we drag and get closer and closer and closer to 40 rectangles, look how good that is. 8.999 compared to actual of 9. So the middle is a great choice. And then another choice, why use rectangles? What if maybe instead we use trapezoids? Ooh, look at that. Look at that. So now with that trapezoid, it is pretty darn good. Pretty amazing. And you can see even as we get up to, 40 trapezoids, we're pretty darn close. So anyway, so this is a fun little website. You can play with it. You can see there's a few different shapes. Here's e to the x. So you can, and let's take it back to a left or a right. And so you can see just different approximations and how they look. And I know we don't know trig, but you can still, there's still interesting functions. And you can see it's kind of fun when you have a right approximation. If the graph is, if your graph is concave down and it's going down, you'll see it's a under approximation. If your graph is decreasing, a right approximation is under approximating. And if your graph is increasing, a right is overestimating. I apologize. It doesn't have anything to do with the concavity. I misspoke. Just the increasing or decreasing. So if the graph's increasing, a right approximation overestimates. If the graph is decreasing, a right approximation underestimates. And then that is the exact opposite for left, which kind of you probably could have figured out. So anyway, come in here, play, get comfortable with it. It's kind of fun. All right. So let's move on. Now, this next part will really help you kind of get how this is related to the derivative and how it's the antiderivative, how it's the opposite of a derivative. Let's quickly sketch a graph. Let's just kind of say, okay, we've got some kind of graph going on here, and they're saying if the units on the dependent axis, the y-axis, were students per classroom. Okay. Students per classroom. Okay. And the units on the x-axis, the d independent axis, were number of classrooms. Number of classrooms. Determine the meaning of the area under the curve. Well, so, and we don't really have a curve, but I will say, determine the meaning of the area under the curve if it were. So we've got some crazy curve, doo-doo-doo-doo, and we found the area under the curve using 1,000 rectangles. I don't know, whatever. Do-do-do-do-do-do, the area under the curve. There we go. And we know that this area equals 3,105. What would the units on it be? Well, how do we come up with it? Well, each of our little rectangles, we'd be doing the width times the height, right? Well, the units on the width is number of classrooms. So it would be some number with the units of classrooms times another number. Instead of using numbers, I'll use an A. Some number times classrooms, and then some number where it's students per classroom. So therefore, that when we multiply those, it would leave us with units of students. So what this would mean is the area under the curve told us that this school in particular, or whatever we were measuring, had 3,105 students. Pretty cool. So let's go back really fast and look at this. Looking at our graph here, if we go back to the very original meaning and we said, okay, this original graph that I gave you was time and velocity, miles per hours. Well, if we kind of assigned that to this, where the dependent is miles per hour and the original amount was hour, the independent axis was hours, then when we multiplied these, we'd be doing miles per hour times hours, which would therefore leave us with the concept of miles. Cool. So therefore what we're saying is we traveled 45 miles or 70 miles. Really cool. So area under the curve, when we're talking about a velocity and a time, then when you find the area under the curve, it's the two of them multiplied. So therefore the units divide, leaving you with just miles. Cool. All right. So what does a definite integral describe? What does a definite integral describe? What we've just been doing is it's the signed area between the function and the x-axis. When we say signed, what we mean is positive or negative. So if the area actually looks something like this, and let's say I told you the area here was 45 and the area under here was 20, and this was from 0 to 17, and I said, hey, find the area under the curve. Well, you'd say, okay, the area for the red section is 45, the area for the green section is negative. It's a 20, but it's negative, so therefore our total area would be 45 minus 20, so that'd make 25. Okay, so does that make sense? When we say signed, what we're saying is if it's above the x-axis, if it's above, when you're thinking about your heights of your, just think about your heights. This has a height of 4, this has a height of negative 12, I don't know, whatever it is. The y values down here are negative. So when I do my length times my width or my length times my height, these are going to be negative values. And then the red ones would be positive values. Okay? So the signed area between the function and the x-axis is what a definite integral describes. It's what we've just been doing. So the notation of the definite integral is pretty simple. It's just saying what we've been doing. Excuse me. It's what we've been doing. It's saying find the area under the curve ranging from some value a to some value b. So you can think of it as this is the start and this is the end. And then f of x is your curve. Okay, so what we're saying here is we have some curve that we're going to find the area under, and we're going to start at A and end at B. And you got to find this area in here. Now the question is how many rectangles should we break this up into? Well, this notation might seem a little familiar. We're used to seeing it like this, d dx, derivative. And the concept there was, well, when we were doing derivatives, it was the limit as h approaches 0, the idea of what is the width between your two points, and the width was approaching 0. This has that same idea. The width is change in x. How far are we moving over from A to the next point? Dx, change in x, change in that direction. And we're going to say it's again approaching 0. So how many rectangles is this? Infinite rectangles. This would be approaching infinitely many rectangles. So how much error should there be? Approximately none, because there's going to be so little error because we're using so many rectangles. Then we got this. It's going to be our area under the curve. Exactly. So again, so this notation, take a look right here. The meaning of A and B. A and B is the start and end of your area. Okay, the meaning of this. Now, I didn't tell you what that means, and this is actually kind of fun. What we're doing here, right? What the big idea here is, what we're doing is taking rectangles and adding them up, right? We're adding up how many of them? Infinitely many. Well, and what's the word we have for add? Way back when we were doing word problems and all that fun stuff, people might refer to it as the sum. Do you see this kind of looks like a fun, really elongated letter S? Yeah, it's not a mistake. The reason they do that is it actually does represent the sum. So what you can see here is this is the f of x is the curve, but that's where we get the height of our rectangle from. The dx is the width. So what we're doing is saying take the height times the width, take those rectangles and sum them up, add them up. So that's literally what this big long S means, is it's the meaning of this. Well, that is called the integral, but it means sum. And the meaning of dx is the width of your rectangle. Okay. So write the previous problem that we just did. Not this one. Write the Here it is, this problem. Forget the endpoints with five subdivisions or whatever. Just write this problem using that notation. Okay? Take a pause, see if you can do it. And if not, you just follow along. I think you'll be pleasantly surprised how nice and simple this is. Okay, so the idea here, we are going to be saying, all right, we want to find the sum. Now, where are we starting? On the old problem, we are going from 0 to 5. So I'm starting at 0 and I'm ending at 5. Now, the height of my rectangles. Well, that was coming from our function. I would just take my x values and substitute them in, and that was x squared plus 3. So there's my height, and then my width was dx. There you go. That is the whole problem. That's how you write it using this notation. Isn't this amazing? It's so much fun. Okay. So you can see now, here's a few problems just for us to kind of practice reading this notation, making sure we understand how to read it and how to use it. So using the graph below, answer the following questions. The given values represent the area under the curve. So this way, because we're not ready yet to really start doing the derivatives, we just need to get comfortable with the notation and the meaning. So remember, it's signed area. So here, this area is 20, this area is negative 40. Okay, so give it a shot. See what you come up with. Try the first one. Okay, so the first one is telling us to add from 0 to 3 on the x-axis. So we're going from 0 to 3. So, and then add up that area under the curve. So that would just be 20. Now let's use our units. Remember, this is a width of 3. A width of 3. I mean, it really doesn't matter because we know the area, the final area is 20, but it's the width, which has a unit of hours times the height, which is miles per hour. So we're left with the units of miles. So what we're saying here is the person drove for 3 hours and they went a total of 20 miles. Okay, so then for the next one, take a look and see what this one is saying and give it a shot. Okay, so hopefully you already saw this. You're like saying, hey, that's easy. That's only going from 0 to 7. That's just this little hump right here, and that's signed area. So that's negative 40 miles. Now, can you really have negative miles? Well, it depends on the context. Remember, this could very well just be describing direction. So we went 20 miles north, then 40 miles south. So therefore, what is this one describing here? What is this problem describing here? Well, it's saying from 0 to 7, what was our total miles traveled? So therefore, 20 minus 40, which would be a negative 20 miles. There you go. So that's how you work it, if negative values are allowed. Now, what if instead of saying, look, all right, so right now what we could see is we are like, if everything of this is north and south, what you could see is like we're 20 miles south of our original position. We're 20 miles south of where we started. But what if instead of caring about north and south, you just wanted to know how many miles did you put on your odometer? How far did you travel? Well, then negative area really doesn't make sense. It doesn't matter which direction you're going, it was just 40. So therefore, what would we need to do to this problem? Well, instead of looking at it as 20 minus 40, we don't care that it's a minus or a plus, which is plus, right? We went 20 miles in one direction, then we went 40 miles in the other direction. Our odometer changed a total of 60 miles. Okay? So, go ahead and practice that. The key thing in this section is really the notation and understanding what the big ideas are, how what we're doing here. So, what are we doing? What is the integral? What was the big idea? What is the integral talking about? Well, integrals, the big idea is they are finding area under a curve. They're talking about the area between the curve and the x-axis. And if it happens to be above or below, it's still area between the curve and the x-axis. And then the next key thing beside that idea of just understanding what's going on is understanding how to read this notation, what it's saying to you. That's going to be the rest of this class. We're going to be using that notation. So make sure that's really solid. Okay? Best of luck, and I'll see you in section 3.2.